Let's get started. So today's going to be devoted to reviewing all the material from the quarter to help you prepare for the final. So a few quick announcements. Like I did for the midterm, I prepared a printable version of the slides from the second half of the quarter. This is like one PDF that has about 50 or 60 pages. And, you know, it's like black text on white background, so you can print it out four slides to a page without wasting a lot of black ink. So you might want to print that out because it's the book. The exam's going to be open book and open notes. Yeah. So I'm going to have an extra hour of office hours today, 2 to 5 instead of 2 to 4, just because the last assignment is due today. And as of now, there's only one of our TA staff that's going to be in the Wilkinson lab tonight from 5 to 7. So you might want to come to my office hours before that to avoid the rush. I hope to release a practice exam tomorrow, similar to the midterm practice exam. Obviously, it's not going to be exactly the same as the final, but hopefully that'll help. And let's get started. Any questions on the project, final exam, administrative stuff before I get started? All right, so I'm going to go through like pretty much one slide for every lecture that we had. And I want you to feel free to stop me at any time during this, because I'm not quite sure which parts of the material were the most confusing for everyone. All right, and we can spend more time on anything that you guys want to. All right, so first of all, I'm going to remind you all of like what the roles of an OS are, just so that you can explain to your friends what you learned in this class or what an OS is. And the way I like to think about it is that the OS provides a user interface for humans to run programs. We don't talk about that in this class. But the other two important features or categories of features are that the OS is a resource manager, allowing multiple programs to share one set of hardware. It's much more useful to be able to run many different programs at once. And it's also a programming interface, an API, for programs to gain access to hardware and other services in such a way that makes it a lot easier to design programs. Okay, so programs don't have to deal with all the different variations in hardware when they're being written. They can just deal with an OS interface that hides some of those details, right? So, you know, again, starting from the beginning of the class, a process, as you know, is a program in execution. We define this thing called limited direct execution as a strategy used by pretty much every OS and every computer system, where a process normally operates as if it has full use of the CPU. So it does arithmetic, it accesses registers, accesses memory, and from its perspective, it doesn't really seem like it's sharing the hardware, but it can only do certain things because the CPUs have at least two different modes, user mode and kernel mode, which prevents certain privileged instructions from being executed while in user mode, and that allows the OS to have exclusive control over setting up the protections and dividing resources and accessing hardware directly, and user programs can't do that directly because the instructions necessary to do that kind of stuff are privileged instructions. Okay, and actually, in most I think that the x86 processor has four different modes, actually, instead of just two. But actually, I think most operating systems only use two out of those four modes. But certain instructions are allowed at each of the four levels. But at the lowest level, the smallest number of instructions are available. And of course, at the highest level, in the kernel supervisor mode, everything's available. But interrupts are the other feature that kind of tie everything together. Because interrupts are events that cause the kernel to run, to switch to kernel mode, and to run a specific piece of software that was set up ahead of time by the OS to run in the event that a certain interrupt happened. Okay. System calls are types of interrupts, software interrupts, sometimes called traps, that can be triggered by a user program in its code to ask the OS to do something on its behalf. And obviously, like throughout all the projects, you've had to do this stuff, so none of that should be surprising or none of this is new, but I just want to remind you of the different terminology here. So the timer interrupt is something we haven't dealt with much in a while, but this, remember, was an interrupt that the kernel can set up to go off after a certain amount of time by configuring the programmable interrupt timer hardware. And this basically is what allows the kernel to schedule a process to run and then be sure that eventually that process will be interrupted and the kernel will get to run again to decide who runs next after some finite amount of time. Okay? So the next topic was process creation and memory layout. So here we saw how variations in CPU architecture can influence OS design. And throughout the course, we focused mainly on the Intel x86 processor because that's what XV6 uses, and that's what most like desktop and laptop computers are using. But it's not the only game in town. And in fact, Linux supports 31 different CPU architectures. And in doing so, Linux is kind of unique in the fact that it supports so many different architectures. Most OSs are designed for like one or two operating systems. Windows is designed exclusively, pretty much, to run on the Intel x86 processor, just like XV6. But you know, if you're designing such an operating system to support many different hardware platforms, you have to make sure you have a clear separation of mechanisms and policies. So in other words, there's low-level code that is specific to the particular hardware that has to be different on every architecture because there are different registers used, different instructions, not just and it's not just a matter of like changing the names from one set of names to another set of names, but often there's a whole different scheme for dealing with different parts of the hardware. Like for example, a virtual memory is a good example where on the Intel x86 hardware, you have like hardware paging, so the CPU expects you to set up a register that points to a page table, and the CPU expects the page table to have a certain structure, and you read through the manual to see what the page table structure should be, and like what bits in the page table entries mean what. That's all specified in the processor manual, right? And XV6 was designed with that processor manual in mind. But other architectures, like some ARM-based architectures, don't use hardware paging. Instead, they just have a software-controlled translation look-aside buffer. So in that case, the OS has instructions available to populate the translation look-aside buffer, which is like a cache of the page table. And in an actual implementation, the OS would have page tables in memory that it manages itself, but then the OS can decide to use whatever structure it wants for those page tables and whatever sizes for the different levels, however many levels it wants. It basically has the freedom to design whatever data structure it wants for those page tables. Okay, and that's so that's a case where the OS can have radically different mechanisms, in this case for virtual memory, depending on what hardware you're using, right? Although, like, if you want to design an OS to support two different architectures that use very different schemes, then you have to try to compromise. And maybe, like, in Linux, for example, if you're designing for one of those ARM architectures, you probably would set up your page tables to look very much like the Intel page tables, just so that the code is like more reusable across all those different platforms. Okay. So in dealing with processes, we looked at the fork system call, and we had a fun question in the midterm about that, which is weird because it runs once and exits twice, creates an exact copy of a process. And at this point, we started to first explore synchronization in some sense, even though we weren't talking about synchronization. But you know, we have two things running at the same time. The scheduler can decide to switch between them at any time. The behavior can be unpredictable, and that's called non-determinism when a program's output is unpredictable. It's also called indeterminate, is another word, indeterminate or non-determinism, right? And of course, these are tricky to debug because they're sensitive to timing, and a Heisenbug is the term we use for a bug that when you observe it, when you observe the behavior, the behavior changes, right? It's like in quantum mechanics, the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. Okay, and a kernel panic, as you've seen many times in your projects, is what happens when the OS causes an exception, doesn't know what to do. and you just want to bail out and tell the user that something's wrong. Really tell the kernel programmer that something's wrong, because the user can't do anything except reboot the machine, but hopefully the kernel programmer can look at it and debug it and fix it so it doesn't happen again. Okay. So virtual memory was a big topic in this class. And before we got into that, we also talked about how the program's memory is organized in a typical operating system. Do I have a picture? Yeah, here. So, like, the idea that you have portions of the virtual memory space that are reserved for the kernel, portions that are reserved for the stack and the heap and the code of the program is like the first thing that's loaded in. And also the global variables are the first. These things are loaded first when you call the exec system call, and then you have a stack that's set up, and this can grow downward, and you generally have mechanisms in the OS, mechanisms may be the wrong word, but you have system calls in the OS, like sbreak and mmap, that let you request more memory. Like sbreak pushes this top of the heap upward, which to the OS, it doesn't really think of it as a heap, it's just like the maximum memory location that the program can access. Although, of course, in XV6, you remember that the stack was down here, just to simplify things. So we talked about what the stack, execution stack is, and what it does. This was kind of a review of the 213 class, just in case you haven't taken that or didn't remember it. But the execution stack makes subroutines really easy to implement in assembly code, and consequently it makes the compiler for C code easier to implement. And of course the purpose of virtual memory, as we all know, is to allow each process to have its own view of memory, and it does that by dividing memory into pages and having a page table that is like a small it's not as big as the full memory because there's only one entry for every page, but it indicates for every virtual page whether that page is available to the process, and if it is available, where in physical memory to find it. So it creates a mapping between virtual memory and physical memory that's different for every process. All right, and actually, more than that, it also allows us to do things like lazy loading and copy on write, which we'll see later. And of course, the nice thing about page tables is that you have many of them defined in memory and ready to go, and you can just change the CPU's, the register in the CPU that points to the page table, which for Intel is CR3, and just by changing that one register, suddenly you can trigger a context switch, meaning that the CPU suddenly switches from a virtual address range from one virtual address range to another, because all the mappings between addresses have suddenly changed. Scheduling is the OS policy for deciding which code runs when, because we saw with limited direct execution that at any given time, there's really only one process running on a given CPU core. Of course, if you have multiple cores, you can have multiple things running at the same time, which unfortunately we didn't get to in this class. I thought we might have time for it, but not so. When scheduling, we had two conflicting metrics to decide what a good scheduling policy was. There was turnaround time and response time, and there's an inherent trade-off between the two. Turnaround time was like the time it takes for the process to finish, and average turnaround time would be the average time for all the processes to finish running, and response time would be the time it takes for a process to start running, which sometimes is actually useful if it's an interactive program. Okay. And we defined two kind of toy simple scheduling policies, shortest job first and round robin, which optimize the two metrics respectively, but are not realistic because for shortest job first, particularly, you don't know how long the job is going to be ahead of time. And for round robin, it doesn't always make sense to switch between processes after a short amount of time because it doesn't give, sometimes it wastes time by doing a lot of switches and giving processes a chance to run when they don't need to run. I mentioned context switching already in the when talking about paging, but in general, this is a context switch is when you switch from running one process to another. And one of the big overheads associated with it, which is not really obvious, is due to CPU caching. So we know the CPU keeps the most recently used data in caches on chip. It's not really visible to the programmer or to the OS, but it's happening behind the scenes. And when you change page tables, the OS has to flush those caches because the addresses that was previously being used no longer are valid with the new page table. So then all the memory accesses will start to take a... When you first start running a process, memory accesses tend to be pretty slow because nothing's in the cache, so every memory access has to go all the way to main memory, which is much slower than going to a cache. Okay. We showed how... So processes have many different states they can go through, like runnable, running, sleeping, or blocked. When a process is waiting for some external hardware to finish finish doing something, it's I/O blocked. And in that case, there's nothing it really can do with the CPU. It's just waiting. But actually, it is sort of making progress. It's making progress on the external hardware. So in a scheduling policy, it makes sense to schedule processes that have a history of becoming I/O blocked frequently, of doing a lot of I/O. So if you schedule those processes in preference to schedule processes that do a lot of CPU work, then you'll tend to make better use of your peripheral I/O devices, right? Because those I/O bound processes will probably in the future, as well as they did in the past, in the future they'll make a lot of I/O requests. And it's better to start those earlier so they can get done sooner. And that doesn't, doing that doesn't really use up much CPU time. And then you still can run your CPU-bound processes after the I/O-bound processes start the requests and when they start waiting, right? The multi-level feedback queue was a pretty clever design for an OS scheduler that balances turnaround time and response time. And it keeps track of, within a certain time window of history, which processes are like polite is a term I like to use. Like they don't use a lot of CPU. They just use a little bit of CPU and then start I/O. And those processes tend to retain high priority, so they're in a higher level of this multi-level feedback queue. And but if processes squander their CPU time, if they use a lot of CPU when they are scheduled, and they'll end up being deprioritized, moved to a lower priority queue. And this scheme will always try to schedule things with high priority, which tend to be processes that do a lot of I/O, but if none of those are available, it moves down to a lower level and lower and so forth, right? So you have multiple different levels that represent different degrees of I/O boundness or CPU hungriness, in a sense. All right, so I already showed this, just remember that the exec system call, which is typically called after a fork, is what loads from a file the binary data into like the code of a program into this low part of memory, and also loads the global data that's defined in that binary file. Of course, the stack grows down whenever you call a function. There's a new stack frame pushed onto the stack. Okay. So another topic we talked about, which was kind of self-contained in a way, was free space management. So specifically, we looked at the code for malloc and free in some depth, because I thought this was a good example that like tied together data structures and operating systems. And I think it's not necessarily obvious to people as when they're writing C code that malloc and free are just library functions, and behind the hood, they use system calls like sbreak or mmap to get their work done, but not all the time, only when they need more memory, right? So we talked about how a free list tracks blocks of free memory by having a linked list and having a little header at the beginning of every element in the list, indicating its size, and with a pointer to the next element. And cleverly, you keep that header around even when you allocate memory to a process and fill it in with a magic number, generally, so that when you call free, the code that handles it can check to see whether that was a valid request and not a double free, and re-add it to the list. And then an additional complication here was that it's possible to have fragmented free space. In other words, if you just run this thing without much sophisticated logic for reorganizing things, you'll end up with small areas of memory that are free, that are scattered throughout the range, and it can be difficult to reuse those because when malloc services a request, it has to provide to the code a contiguous region of memory of the size that was requested. So your implementation may actually need to move things around, which is kind of similar to the problem we saw again sort of in disk file system disk management, right? So the same thing is true on a disk. With file systems, you do have the freedom with inodes to point to buffers that are in like radically different parts of the disk, but you generally don't want to do that because we know that reading contiguous blocks of the disk is much faster. So that same goal of avoiding fragmentation exists both in free space management for dynamic memory allocation and also in disk space management for file systems, although we didn't really go into it with file systems. We didn't really go into it much here either. I already talked a little bit about virtual memory, but when I revisited that topic, we talked in detail about like what the page tables look like and how the page table entries store both like the high bits of the address and then some bits to indicate the status of that entry, whether it's valid, read-only, read-write, accessible only to the kernel. And we had a translation look-aside buffer to solve the problem of paging introducing like several additional memory reads every time you access memory, which would be a bad thing if you really had to do that every time. So instead, the translation look-aside buffer keeps a short list of maybe like 128, let's say, recently used mappings from virtual to physical memory. This is stored in the CPU, and it makes things faster. And in general, when we talk about caches, a cache hit means the entry was found, and you can quickly service the request. But a cache miss means that we have to go to, in this case, the main memory, but whatever is being cached, the main data source, the full data source, and get the entry and pull it into the cache. And that's much slower, but then the next time we access the same thing, it'll be faster, right? Another problem we had with paging, with a naive approach to paging, was if we have a large memory address space, but we're only using a little bit of memory in a process, we could have really huge page tables. And the solution to that was to use a multi-level page table. In this case, you can reduce space overhead for the sparse address spaces because one page directory entry can represent a huge range of memory, like maybe 4 gigabytes or 4 megabytes of memory instead of 4 kilobytes, something like that. Yeah, so you can represent empty areas much more efficiently. You can also use super pages or huge pages to solve the same problem of reducing the page size, but even in cases when you are using a lot of memory, as long as that memory is contiguously laid out in physical memory. Okay. So swapping was another thing we talked about. This is when the OS tries to make the physical memory, tries to deal with the fact that physical memory is small, can be small, and but processes may demand more memory in general that is available, but you want to be able to like temporarily allow, you want to be able to allow those processes to use more memory than is available by temporarily moving unused parts of memory onto disk. Because disks have a ton of space, but they're slow. So this is kind of a caching situation again, similar to the TLB and page tables, except it's between physical memory is the cache in some sense, of the disk, which stores the full record of virtual memory. Okay, this is the first time we talked about magnetic disks, which of course have very high throughput, but very high latency. So you can transfer a lot, especially if it's contiguous on the disk, but it takes a long time to start a request, generally, because you have to wait for the rotation to the right location to finish and for the read head to move to seek to the right radial location. And paging and swapping actually work together in some sense because they use the same CPU mechanisms. A page table entry, when it's marked not present, it could be either invalid or swapped to disk. This same mechanism can be used for lazy allocation, lazy loading, copy on write in the file system, or for processes. So for example, I think my favorite example is copy on write with fork, where you have a process that wants to create a sub-process and it calls fork. If this is a large process, then that could be very slow. Like if that process is using like 500 megabytes of memory, making a copy, like theoretically, you should copy all 512 megabytes of memory for the new process, but there are two reasons why you don't want to do that. First of all, the child process could be short-lived and only like use a small amount of that memory. And secondly, the child process could really use none of that memory if the next thing that's going to happen is going to be an exec sys call, which copies code from a binary file and erases the entire virtual memory space. So to optimize for both of those cases, you can use copy on write, which just like sets the pages for that parent process to read only, and then in the child process, creates a page table that's a duplicate, almost exactly, of the parent, except it'll have a different stack, like a thread. And then whenever either the parent or the child edits any of those pages that are shared, they're not supposed to be shared, but the OS has decided to share them. The OS sets a not present bit on the appropriate page table entry, that'll generate a page fault, and the OS can handle it by then on demand creating a copy of just that particular page that it knows is actually being used by the child and the, or at least it's being modified by the parent or child, so that the state of those two processes can then truly fork and go in different directions. We talked about page replacement policies to deal with this caching of virtual memory in physical memory, or swapping between physical memory and disk. And the purpose of the policy is to decide which page to evict to free up some memory space to make room for new pages that are being demanded. And swapping can happen on demand, meaning when there's a request that can't be serviced because there aren't any free physical pages, then you swap, or it can be done in the background ahead of time to anticipate future requests for memory. And generally, it's better to do it in the background if you can, because then you don't have unexpected delays in program execution, and you can schedule this background work to happen during idle times, right? So that's a good optimization that most OSs implement. Right. And so some of the other bits in the page table entries that we haven't talked about yet that are useful for swapping are the accessed bit and the dirty bit. And these are set automatically by the CPU whenever memory is read or written. This is a really helpful hardware feature because it allows the OS, even though the OS isn't like informed of the memory access pattern that the programs or the processes have, usually those are usual level instructions that don't involve any OS interference, but the CPU kind of leaks a little bit of information about the memory accesses of the processes by setting the access bits and dirty bits in the page table entries for processes as they run. And it all happens kind of like automatically and quickly. Okay. I quickly defined the term thrashing for a system that's experiencing so much swapping that the system doesn't do any work. And this is a situation that you might experience in real life if you run a program, if you write a program that has a memory leak, that uses too much memory, because then you end up doing a lot of swapping. Or if you're trying to run too many programs at the same time, they're just memory hungry. At that point, it's better to, well, in the first case, obviously fix the bug that's causing memory leak, but in the second case, if you just try to do less, like kill one of the processes and run it later, overall you'll be better off because swapping really slows things down dramatically. Okay, still going. So still on the topic of memory management, I mentioned copy on write. I think I already mentioned that, so I'm going to skip right through that. But related to that is demand zeroing. So when a process requests more memory from the OS using SBreak or MMAP, another kind of like lazy optimization the OS can do is to not service the request, but just mark the pages as not present and deal with them later if they're used. So again, we're kind of hoping that the process is asking us to do something it doesn't, we don't really need to do. And sometimes we're right, and therefore, and that saves us some effort sometimes. We also have the caching, we also have file system caching, which we saw in the in XP6 operating system with the buffer cache, which pulls blocks of disk into memory to be manipulated more quickly than actually doing a disk request every time you access a file. And this makes the file system appear as fast as RAM, but it only works for a small part of the file system at a time, only the amount that can fit in the space that the OS has dedicated for caching. But if you combine, you can actually look at file system caching and swapping at the same time to come up with a unified paging policy that considers, okay, I have a certain amount of physical memory, and this is where work can be done essentially on the computer, and the OS can decide which processes can use which parts of that physical memory at a given time, but also which parts of the file system that are being used frequently should be given a place in memory so the access to those files is quick. So it actually makes sense to consider those two separate policies at the same time, the swapping policy and the caching policy, file system caching policy, because they both use the same resource, physical memory, to implement themselves. Right. All right, so threads should be pretty clear to you from the third project, but to remind you, processes can have multiple threads that share the same virtual address space, and when you do that, when you have that situation, you're likely to come up with synchronization problems. In other words, critical sections, which are blocks of code that must be run atomically. And if you don't protect your critical sections, you can have race conditions that make code indeterminate. We already talked about that with fork, although it really becomes more prominent with threading, because in that case, you're actually sharing memory. You're not just, like the example I gave with fork indeterminate non-determinism was kind of was not super interesting because the race condition was just on the output to a shared file, which in this case was standard output. Like what it was printing to the screen would be different, but in case of shared memory, you could have drastically different like numerical results if there's an error. And locks are the way that we generally deal with synchronization and protecting critical sections. So they're a mutual exclusion primitive that has two functions, acquire or lock, to get exclusive access to the shared resource. And if you're not able to get exclusive access because someone else is using it, has already locked it, then you just wait until you can acquire the lock. So these cause threads to stop their progress if the critical section has been entered by someone else. And then there's a release or unlock function to release the shared resource and let someone else enter. And concurrency happens for two reasons. We haven't talked about it so much in this class, but the first reason it occurs is in multi-CPU systems. So if you have, you actually can have two things that run at the same time, or four things, or eight things, or more. And you know, that concurrency is quite natural in a sense. And those two CPUs could be running threads that are using the same virtual memory space. But the concurrency is also created artificially by the OS scheduler in a single CPU system, but also in multi-CPU systems, because the OS can interrupt a process as it's going and cause something else to run and switch back to it. And that kind of like staggered, that switching between different processes, if you zoom out and kind of look at the big picture, it looks like everything is running at the same time, although everything runs in like spurts, you know. So to implement locks, we needed some hardware support because the basic operations provided, like memory reads and arithmetic and write and loads and stores, none of those individual instructions can do enough to basically test a condition and set a variable at the same time, which is what you really need for a lock. The different hardware options are, you know, various instructions that are available in processors. Test and set, compare and swap, and fetch and add are the clearest ones and the most popular ones. Load length and store conditional is a different way of doing of handling synchronization using hardware primitives, which is actually kind of interesting. If you remember, the way load linked works is that you load a value from memory into a register, and then you do whatever you want with it. But then when you later want to store that value back to the same register, I mean, you store it, it could be a different value that you're storing back. But anyway, if you are, when you call store conditional, it only succeeds if no other thread has called load link to the same address before you did. And I guess it would probably have to use a change of the page table to know whether it was you or someone else that called load linked. Yeah. And there are different kinds of lock implementations, from a very simple spin lock that just causes a process to keep checking the lock repeatedly using the CPU, to a ticket lock, which also has the same kind of checking, but at least it orders the entry into the critical section or the acquisition of the lock according to the order in which the lock was requested. And this is especially easy to implement using fetch and add. And some of the problems that arose with these spinning locks was that we were wasting CPU time if a process couldn't access the lock. And to deal with that, we had yielding locks and queuing locks. And both of these required new functionality from the OS to allow the process to somehow control scheduling, which is totally new. In the past, we've assumed that the processes are not really aware at all of anyone else executing, and they think they're running all the time, and therefore it doesn't make sense for them to try to influence scheduling. But in order for locks to work well, it really makes sense to coordinate between the user code that's locking and the OS scheduler. And the futex is a great example of that, as well as the park and unpark on Solaris, where the OS actually provides a locking primitive in Linux that sleeps the process when it can't acquire a lock that it's asking for. And then when a lock is released, the OS will wake up the appropriate process waiting for that lock in the order that it was acquired. And that's really everything we want in a locking mechanism. One disadvantage of some of these locking approaches, these ones that involve context switches, is that context switch overhead is high in general. So we often see two-phase locking implemented in real life, where you try spinning for a while just in case the lock might be released by a thread that's running on a different processor. And if after like 3 or 4 or 10 attempts, 10 checks, which would just be like a few nanoseconds or maybe a microsecond, if after that short period of time you still can't get the lock, then it makes sense to release the CPU and do a context switch. So then you end up using like unscheduling the process and switching to a different process until actually the OS can decide, the OS knows that the lock has been released. That's how the food text is implemented on Linux. So to implement concurrent data structures, we had a few different approaches. The simplest one was to use one big lock so that only one thread at a given time can use the data structure at all, and this works. And it's easy to implement, and it's unlikely to create bugs, to introduce bugs like a deadlock. But it's not very, it can be inefficient if you have, if you really want multiple threads to access a data structure, especially if a data structure is large and has a lot of components that could be accessed in parallel. We saw how you could start to make data structures concurrent, you know, more concurrent by having multiple locks that apply to different parts of the data structure. So for a queue, for example, you can have one lock for the head and one lock for the tail, and one thread could access the head to add to remove things, and one thread could access the tail to add things. So one could remove, one could add, and you know that allows two things to work at the same time. More than that, a concurrent hash table, for example, could use one lock per bucket in the hash table, and then you can have up to, you know, for n buckets, you can have n threads adding, either putting or getting values from the hash table. And hash tables actually are really good for concurrency for that reason. I briefly introduced condition variables, which are an alternative primitive for synchronization, and they use a signal and wait functions, or up and down. But they're kind of hard to use. But anyway, wait puts a thread to sleep, and signal wakes a waiting thread. I'm sorry. What I just said was wrong. I was thinking of semaphores, which have up and down, not signal and wait. Okay. Condition variables are important. Rewind. Yeah. So condition variables are ways for threads to communicate. And there's a signal command to wake a thread that's waiting on the on a variable, on a condition variable, and there's a wait command to wait for a signal. So this allows threads to communicate with each other and basically to signal each other so that work can happen in a certain ordering. So task A gets done by thread A, and then task B can get done by thread B, but then thread B can do task C, but task C might require the outputs of task A that was running a different process, so in that case it makes sense to have a condition variable to signal for the first thread, to signal to the second thread that it's done with its work, so that the aggregation work done by the second thread can proceed. Okay. And one tricky thing about this is that the pthread's implementation of condition variables actually allows spurious wakeups. So you have to like remember to check the status when you're woken up. It may have been a fake wake up, so you have to check that. But actually, in reality, if you're using condition variables, it might make sense to implement your own little like library functions, your helper functions that handle this spurious wake ups on within that function. Yeah. They're similar in a sense, yeah. So park and unpark are, so if I remember correctly, when you park, that causes you to wait for something, and when you unpark, it wakes up someone else who is parked. So signal and wait. So wait is like park, and signal is like unpark. So I think that the answer is that you can implement signal and wait using, I think that they're kind of analogous. Yeah. But we talk about signal and wait because these are these are specific functions implemented in the pthreads library that's available on a lot of different Unix operating systems, whereas park and unpark are system calls in Solaris that are not necessarily available on like Linux. So park and unpark are system calls in Solaris. Futex is a there are a few system calls on Linux related to futexes. So that's like, and then, you know, you can use either one of those to implement signal and wait, but signal and wait are not they're not system calls. They're implemented by the pthreads user library. So it's kind of like we have malloc and free in user level libraries to deal with memory management, but then to actually get the work done within those functions, we use like sbreak or mmap to get more memory from the operating system. That's kind of the analogous situation here. And like malloc, depending on the implementation in the operating system, your malloc implementation might use sbreak or it might use mmap. You know, it depends on what system you're on. Similarly, your signal and wait might use park and unpark or it might use futex. Okay. That's a good question. Okay, so a third friend of these two commands is broadcast, which is kind of like signal, except it doesn't wake up one thread, but wakes up every thread waiting. And this is useful in some situations where you need to, not all the waiting threads are equivalent, so you have to like go, maybe all of them need to wake up to figure out if I'm the one that needs to proceed and do some work, rather than relying that any one of the waiting threads can do something meaningful in response to the signal. Okay. Producer-consumer queues were a data structure that was implemented using two condition variables to implement a common paradigm of having a queue that manages the flow of data from one thread to another. So if you have a pipeline of calculation or request management, where you have several steps in a process, the first step, when it finishes its work, can put its result in this producer-consumer queue. It's the producer in this case. And then the consumer on the other side of the queue, that's completing all the requests in the next step of the process, can just try to keep pulling intermediate results from the queue. But you know, because the producer and consumer would proceed it with different speeds, you need a queue between them that can synchronize them. And what can serve as a buffer so that if for a short period of time the producer is going faster than the consumer, then it can actually continue to do work and store all of its intermediate results in the queue up to a certain point because there's a limited capacity of the queue. But then eventually if the consumer starts to run faster, it can pull off elements from the queue faster than the producer is adding things to the queue. And so it kind of like smooths out the variation in compute speeds between two steps in a pipeline to make the overall system like operate with maximum utilization, if that makes sense. The next topic was synchronization bugs, and this is okay. Semaphores, obviously, was what I was trying to talk about before, which I'm not even going to mention much now. But it's another all-purpose synchronization primitive that has an up and down functions associated with it. Reader-writer locks, I think, are more interesting because it's like a generalization of locks where whether or not you allow multiple readers to access a critical section but only one writer, and it's very common in data structures that have a distinction between readers and writers for different operations. This allows some concurrency within a critical section, but only for reads and not for writes. We saw that adding too many locks to your code can lead to deadlock, and some of you may be experiencing that in your current project. And If you forget to release your locks, that can also release a deadlock. So you have to remember to unlock after you lock, to release buffers after you reserve them, and not to create circular waiting conditions where A is holding a lock and waiting for a second lock, and then B is holding the lock that the first process is waiting for, but waiting for the lock that the first process is holding. Okay. In order to get deadlock, theoretically, there are four conditions necessary. First, mutual exclusion, that you're actually using locks that will cause waiting. Hold and wait, meaning that when you get a lock, you never release it. And one of the strategies to avoid deadlock is the try lock primitive, which allows you to, if you're getting multiple locks, when you try to acquire the second lock, try lock can tell you ahead of time whether or not it's going to succeed. Because remember, the normal lock function just waits until you can actually succeed and acquire it. The try lock gives you like warning that, okay, you're going to be able to get it or you're going to have to wait. And it tells you that you're going to have to wait, what you can do is release the first lock and then wait before you try again. And by releasing that first lock, you allow someone else who might be waiting for that first lock to acquire it. And that avoids deadlock for that reason, right? Because you're actually not holding on to the resource, you're releasing it periodically. And the other condition is no preemption. In other words, the OS can't go in and release locks from processes that are holding them. And finally, you need circular wait to have deadlock. And this is the most common cause of problems with deadlock, where, especially if you're acquiring locks in a different order in different processes, the same locks, then if those happen at the same time, you have circular waiting. Okay. I showed the dining philosopher's example, which is just a toy example of deadlock. And in that case, circular wait can be avoided by making one of the philosophers use a different protocol for getting locks. In other words, grabbing right before left instead of left and then right. So the next big topic was I/O, and this maybe is more familiar because we were just working on it. So I'm going to try to go through this more quickly. But generally, we have a layered design in most I/O systems and operating systems. And important thing to remember always about disks is that random access to a magnetic disk, anyway, is about 1,000 times slower than sequential access. So most of the code, low-level code, and even the high-level code that is written for storage systems, it keeps this in mind and tries to do whatever it can to sequentialize reads and writes, to read large amounts of data at once, to write large amounts of data at once. If you're just accessing a small amount of data, then maybe try to use a cache or delay that operation until you have more work to do. We introduced RAID as a way to deal with some disk shortcomings, like the fact that disks can fail more so than any other part of a computer. Disks are liable to failure because of the mechanical rotation involved and the seeking, and also the limited capacity of disks. Both of those things can be solved with RAID by using multiple disks at the same time. There are a few different types of RAID. The most interesting one was RAID 5 that uses parity to introduce just a little bit of space overhead to provide redundancy for a large number of disks. Okay. So file systems, we talked about the application level API for file I/O, like these syscalls. But below that, where what's maybe more interesting is the file system structure, because there are many different ways to implement a file system, and there are always new file systems being introduced. What you saw in XV6 and in the lecture slides was the sort of classic Unix file system, and that uses inodes and an arrangement of the disk where like different parts of the disk are dedicated to different parts of the file system. Like there's a part for inodes, there's a part for data buffers, and inodes referred to data blocks, I should say, not buffers. And then you have bitmaps a bitmap for the data blocks, which indicates which of the data blocks are being used with a 0 or 1 value. And actually, you generally would also have an inode bitmap that indicates which of the inode structures are being used. And inodes implement a multi-level tree to refer to blocks. And this is a good design because it's optimized for the common case of small files that only have a few blocks of data. In that case, you only have to check like one level of pointer, and that's fast. But for larger files, you introduce an additional indirection, so you have to like read, look at two pointers to find the data, or three pointers for a double indirect, or four pointers for quad indirect, or triple indirect. But that's the penalty you pay for the rare case that you have a large file. Right. Yeah, so this shouldn't say that. Yeah. So pretty much every operating system has some kind of buffer cache to try to reduce the number of times you go to disk to read data. And the XV6 one is pretty simple. It just has a linked list of buffers. Every buffer has like a sector number and disk number listed in it. And whenever you read or write to a block of disk, the OS first checks that buffer cache to see whether it can find the data there. The idea of write-ahead logging, I think, is pretty important and interesting for making accesses to disk appear atomic, even if there's a possibility that the machine is powered down right in the middle of a transaction. This is a case where we have a sort of, not really concurrency, but it's something like concurrency, where a transaction, a critical section, could be interrupted, not because something else is run, but because just the system is rebooted suddenly, right? And for the file system, it's really important, because the file system is persistent. It's important that if we're making related changes to like inodes and bitmaps that depend on each other, that what's written to disk and persisted to disk is consistent, and that we're not interrupted before we can make things consistent. So the way that was done with write-ahead logging is to write that important data twice. We write it to log first, which is a special part of the disk that stores transactions that are in flight, and then you write a special message in the log indicating that, okay, that's everything in this transaction, and now I'm going to write to the main disk. And you start writing to the main disk. And if you're interrupted at any point in that sequence, you can recover from it because you have that copy. So if you're interrupted before you wrote the, hey, I'm finished message to the log, then you can roll back the transaction by just deleting the contents of the log, because you know that whatever's in the log is a partial set of only a part of the transaction. You don't have enough information to finish the transaction, but you also know that you haven't started to implement the transaction in the actual main part of the disk, so there's no harm in rolling back the transaction. Or if you see in the log that there is a finalization message in the log, then you know that you have a full record of what is in the transaction, and you can replay it by writing all those changes to disk from the beginning based on what you see in the log. You just like replay everything that's in the log. And that'll make it atomic, right? I'm going to skip that storage layer interactions slide. So the final topic that we talked about yesterday was, not yesterday, 2 days ago, was log structured file systems. And again, I think this is an interesting topic. It's because it is a recent advance in file systems. And in this case, it's a totally different design for file systems. It still uses inodes and data blocks, but it doesn't like put them in different parts of the disk. That was a simpler design. This is more complicated. But the advantage is that it allows a lot of your writes to happen sequentially, because you're basically always writing to the end of the disk. Sort of. I mean, not completely. And you never go back and edit data that's on disk. You just write new copies of the data that is edited, and you stop referring to the old copies. So you end up with inodes that are scattered throughout the disk, which creates a problem of like knowing where to find inodes. You solve that problem using a checkpoint region. This is like the one thing in file system that you always know where to find it. And it generally would be like at the beginning of the disk, maybe, or at the end of the disk, or the second block of the disk, something like that. So you know, in the checkpoint region, you have pointers to a distributed inode map, which itself indicates where the inodes are. And so the checkpoint region is the only thing that's always written to a well-known location on disk. And if you keep around old versions of the checkpoint region, so if you have several checkpoint regions, each one of those checkpoint regions represents a snapshot of the file system at a point in time of in the past. So you can actually like go through time. This is how the Time Machine feature works on Mac OS, and see like what was in the document before I saved it, things like that. So which is pretty cool. So to make this work, because the disk isn't actually infinite in size, you have to have a garbage collector that goes through and scans the file system to get rid of old stuff. If you kept stuff around forever, then you'd have like a full history of all of the changes ever made to the file system, which would be cool, but you probably don't have space for that, so the garbage collector cleans up old data, meaning that that's not new enough for you to care about, depending on how you configure it. And it also compacts segments that have some old unused blocks inside of them. So generally, the system is divided into segments, and you know, like so. If this is a segment that has like has valid data here and here, and the rest is old data that's no longer being used, you can free this whole block as long as you take these few parts that are still being used, and you put those in memory, like you put those in the next segment that's about to be written to disk. So you kind of like you keep the stuff that you need to keep, and you get rid of all the stuff you don't need to get rid of, and you kind of free a whole big segment of disk at once. And it's nice to have big segments of disk free because those are easier to write to. Yeah, question. Yeah. Well, they wouldn't be. Oh, so that's what I said was a simplification. So if you didn't have versioning, then you could put it like always in the first location. But in reality, what you might do is, so here's the simplest solution, which is described in the book. It's like use the first part of the disk and the last part of the disk for checkpoint regions, and you alternate between the two. So they're both well-known locations, and like if you know that your current version is at the end of disk, then you know that if you want to check history, you go to the front of disk, and vice versa. Or you could have like the first 10 like segments of the disk are all 10 different checkpoint regions, and you kind of go through them one at a time. So you'd have to introduce some additional complexity. It could be at the very beginning of the disk, like the very beginning you have a super block that says like, okay, the current version of the critical region is in block 3, and then you could have. So you have to design a data structure to do this. So I am presenting a simplification, I guess. But it is true. It's written to a well-known location. It doesn't have to be the beginning. It at least has to be locatable through a well-known location. So like the way I would implement it, just off the top of my head, would be at the very beginning of the disk, you store a number that tells you where to find the current checkpoint region, and maybe you reserve the front portion of the disk for several checkpoint regions. Okay. And then you'd know, and then like each one of them would have like the time written of when it was. So if you wanted to figure out what history do I have, you can go through all of these and check all the times. But then at a given point in time, you would check this number to know like what is the latest version. Okay. All right. So, and then you know, through the action of this garbage collector, you create openings in the file system throughout the disk, and when you reach the end of the disk, you can go back to the beginning. If you run out of space, you go back to the beginning and write out new data just in the holes that were created, assuming there are holes. And if there aren't any holes, your disk is full, and you need to either delete old versions or tell the user that they don't have any space, right? Okay, so at this point, I was planning to do a break, which I'm sure you all are exhausted, because I am. We have 15 minutes left in class, so let's do a 2-minute break, and then I have a few more things I want to say. I'll say 3-minute break, okay? Okay, we're back. Okay, so the last thing I'm doing here is trying to draw connections between the different topics we covered in class. And I think many of these are the same kind of things I'm gonna be thinking about when I think of questions for the final exam, that, you know, draw together multiple different parts of the class, right? So the themes that come to my mind are the following. So hardware support, virtualization, caching and buffering, safely sharing resources, and laziness. And there are probably maybe some other good themes you can come up with as well. So let's talk about each one. So hardware features, I think throughout the class there are different hardware features that came up that were things that the OS can use to get its work done, but are not really these go above and beyond the basic like C functionality that you think of. When you think about programming, you think of language like C or whatever language of your choice that could translate in your mind to certain machine instructions. But you need more than just those things to implement an operating system, and this has come up over and over again in class. So, for example, we have privileged and kernel mode, privileged mode and user mode. And we have privileged instructions, so that allowed isolation and limited direct execution. We had interrupts, which were kind of a complicated topic unto themselves. But remember, the way those worked was that the kernel specified that the CPU should jump to certain code to handle an interrupt. So essentially, the kernel wrote to memory in certain locations that and set certain CPU registers to point to tables in memory that told the CPU for every interrupt that could happen, what should you do? Like, what code should you run? Those are called like trap frames in x86 lingo. Software interrupts were used, and these were kind of a complement to the idea of two different modes of execution. But in user mode, if you really need to do something, involving the hardware or something privileged, you can use a software interrupt, of course, to trigger a system call to make the kernel do something for you or ask the kernel to do something for you. Whether or not the kernel does it is up to the kernel, right? The kernel can always deny a request. We saw that in your implementation of system calls. You know, hopefully you're checking the arguments that come in, that they actually like belong to the user's memory space, and so on and so forth. The other hardware features were like page tables and TLB, translation look-aside buffer, that made page tables more efficient. And in synchronization, like in the synchronization section of the class, we talked about these atomic instructions like test and set, compare and swap, that allow you to implement locks or lock-free synchronization in the case of load length and store conditional. And then even recently in the I/O section of the class, we saw that there were like special instructions in and out that allow you to do I/O, and there was also memory mapping that happened actually outside the CPU, but it's still hardware that allow you to access hardware devices by just reading or writing to certain memory locations. Okay, so those are all cases where you need to understand the hardware and more than just regular C programming to implement the OS. And these things provided tremendous benefits for the OS designer. The next topic or theme is virtualization or abstraction. And limited direct execution is a good example of that, because it's the idea that processes think that they have the full CPU to use, although in reality they don't. The system call interface is another good example, because it provides like a high-level API for programs to access resources. Like for example, if a program runs open and then it gives a file name and a certain mode, read and write, then this simple, relatively simple call ends up involving a lot of complex machinery at the OS level. Like it has to involve the file system to figure out what inode this file refers to. It'll invoke some kind of security system and a real operating system to figure out like what user owns that file. Is this the same user as the user that of the program, of the process that made this call? Should I allow it? And then even further down, to find the inodes and get the data, you have to interact with the device driver to get data from the disk. And between there are buffers and everything else, right? So tons of details that are hidden from the programmer and makes life easy for the programmer. So not only is the writing of code simplified, but it also allows distribution of code to be simplified. And we haven't really talked about this too much, but like the same program binary that you compile on one machine can be used on a different machine, assuming certain conditions hold. So you know the hardware can be different to a certain extent. Like if I'm running the latest version of Red Hat Linux and I compile a binary and I send it to you and you're running the same version, then you should be able to run it. That's because the OS interface is the same in those two cases. And specifically, what's called the application binary interface, the ABI, not PI, B, which is the low-level OS and process, defines the low-level OS process and library interactions. So in other words, like the way that system calls are invoked, the numbers of the system calls, the parameters that go into system calls, those all are part of the application binary interface. And if that's the same, then you can use the same binaries on different machines, which is nice because users generally don't want to compile code from scratch. And if you're a company trying to make money, you don't want to distribute your source code necessarily. You just want to distribute binaries to users so they can run that they can run. And but you know, even if your OS is somewhat different and has a different application binary interface, like if different system calls are available, or the system calls have different numbers or take different parameters, which happens over time as an operating system evolves, right? Operating systems are not static. Even if those system calls change over time, sometimes libraries, the API provided by the operating system could remain roughly the same. So it could be that even if I write a relatively simple program to run on Unix, and I wrote it 10 years ago for an old version of Solaris. If all it's doing is like printf and malloc and free and it's relatively simple operations, I should be able to take that C code and compile it on a modern Linux machine today or a Mac and have it run. I couldn't take the same binary that was compiled back then and run it on my new machine because it could be a different operating system. Like it could be, like I said, a Mac instead of Linux, or you know, Linux instead of Solaris. So the system calls are different. The way system calls are handled is different. But at the API level, it could provide the same like POSIX interface for in terms of the user functions that are provided. Yeah. So another theme in the class was caching. And this is important because like in storage, for example, you have vastly different capacities and latencies. So 10 billion times greater capacity on disk compared to registers, and 10 million times more latency when going to disk compared to registers. And then all different levels in between in the hierarchy, including L2, L3, and L1 CPU caches, RAM, SSDs are kind of a level in the storage hierarchy. So you have to choose slow and fast or big and slow, generally. But the OS can dynamically make these choices for you and try to use small and fast whenever it can. And what's interesting about caches is that both the software and the hardware kind of are aware of them and have implicit agreements about them, specifically that there's temporal locality and spatial locality. Temporal locality means that the same data is accessed frequently. So like the hardware caching that's invisible to the OS makes repeated access to the same data locations faster, generally. And similarly, software should be written and compiled to reuse the same memory locations to take advantage of, because to take advantage of that pact that it has with the hardware, right? And that pact exists because of due to the actual implementations and the history of how programs are typically written. It's a sensible to assume temporal locality and also spatial locality, that you're going to access nearby data frequently. So in the hardware level, the caching generally pulls big chunks of data into cache, so you have nearby values on hand and available for requests. Like if you're going sequentially through memory, you'll be able to access the next value typically through a cache. And again, software should be written and compiled to move sequentially through data to take advantage of that. And we know that rotating disks are especially sensitive to doing random versus sequential access. There's a very different amount of latency involved. These are all examples of caches and buffers. The one I want to point out now, because we're running out of time, that's kind of interesting. I don't know if you're aware of this, but there's some hard drives that are like hybrid or fusion disks, which have a combination of solid state storage and magnetic rotating storage. So you might have like 100, let's say you have 100 gigabytes of solid state storage available and a terabyte of magnetic storage, so 10 times more on the magnetic medium. And these are all in one box. And to the OS, it looks like one array of bytes, one drive. But then internally, the logic of the firmware of the disk is deciding which parts of the disk are used very frequently, and those parts of the disk are moved to solid state memory because it's faster. What else? Not too interesting. Laziness, yeah. So, last idea, laziness is a virtue. Don't believe your mother. So the main idea here in operating systems is that often programs ask you to do things that you don't really need to do. So fork was a great example where the program is asking you to copy all of its memory, but it's likely you don't really need to do that. There are other examples, but I think I'm running out of time, so I better let you guys go, easy of class. So that's it. Like I said, practice exam hopefully will be out tomorrow. Open book, open notes, finish your project. Extra office hours today. See you on Monday. So 3:00 here Monday is the exam, right? We all know this. 3 p.m. on Monday. Good. 2 hours long.